Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Nurse by J.A. Corrigan, narrated by Penny Andrews and Andy Creswell.
Prologue, Queen's Hospital, Derbyshire, May 2015. This new space is too quiet. No music, no background chatter. Nothing. The young man tries to move his lips to ask if someone can put the radio on, but the muscles in his face won't obey his command. He can breathe, obviously, and hear, but he can't move or speak. Can't seem to open his eyes either. A male voice, he thinks his doctor, told him that he's been brought out of an induced coma and moved from intensive care. He's now in the hospital's high dependency unit. As well as silence, a dense humidity envelops him in this new room. He wishes a nurse would take off the sheet. He attempts to remember something about his life, anything, but the fog inside his brain is making it difficult. He tries to move again, but his limbs are utterly unresponsive. Then a familiar aroma enters the unfamiliar room. It's the nurse, he thinks. She smells of cinnamon, and she's the one who talks to him. He likes that. The other members of staff never talk. They perform their duties and leave. She's moving around his bed, but she hasn't spoken. His mother smelt of cinnamon a long time ago, and it's as if his senses and subconscious are working to create another plane of time. A fragmented memory stabs him. His mother has been here to see him, before, when he was in intensive care, and told him something she thought he couldn't hear. She didn't think he'd pull through. He listens hard. He won't know for certain who's in the room until they speak. What did his mother tell him? Her words are somewhere inside his mind. He will remember. Soon. He gives up attempting to think and instead allows himself to give in to sleep. And to his relief, a curtain begins to close across his consciousness. It is only the smell of cinnamon that stops him from drawing the other in the matching pair. Then a voice speaks. I'm so sorry. He's uncertain of its timbre, unsure if it's a man or a woman, doubtful of the smell, and panic begins to press inside him. Something is very wrong. All the moments of his existence come together in a kaleidoscope of images, and he sees his wife, her already burgeoning belly taut, the dark skin of her face translucent with happiness. And as his life ebbs away, he acknowledges that his efforts to find the truth have all been in vain. The curtains close, with no gap remaining for the light to enter. He has gone.
Chapter 1. Rose. 8th of December 2015. My eyes sweep the courtroom and settle on my husband, and I accept my life is over. Despite his love, and perhaps because of it. I look at the woman who will soon deliver my sentence. She is petite, pretty, and too young to be a judge, surely. A mixture of expressions have passed over her features during the course of my hearing. Well-veiled disgust at what I've admitted to. Frustration that I've given no reason for what I've done. And sadness when confronted with the victim's wife and baby. But today, for a moment, I see a sliver of compassion. She has no questions left to ask me. I have confessed to Abe Duncan's murder. And that is that. A shaft of winter sun finds its way through the high-set windows, slicing across her left cheek. She leans forward, and a silver crucifix slips out from the collar of her white blouse, glinting in the laser light. and as I question whether she should be wearing this statement of her faith, she lifts her hand and pushes it back beneath the silky fabric. We all need to share the consequences of our decisions sometimes. Again, I look at my husband. I cannot bear to see his pain, which is not only mirroring my own, but amplifying it also. He's the one who's been here for me. Always. The room is filled to capacity, and my gaze shifts to a man in the public gallery who is staring at me with intent and inquisitiveness. He has nut brown skin and wears an unzipped North Face jacket. He must be so hot. I study him for a few more seconds, but then turn away and focus on the judge. Her dark, intelligent eyes move over the faces packing the courtroom as she sums up my crime. It's premeditation. It's callousness. My admission of guilt. She ends her soliloquy with the heartache that I've caused Abe Duncan's wife and family, although his parents have been absent throughout my hearing. This is one thing for which I can be grateful. I wait. 20 years. I'm almost relieved. Chapter 2, 19th of March, 2016. I've been in prison for 3 months, and the monotony, the routine, the ambiguously pleasing absence of freedom are turning out to be surprising comforts of life inside. There is, though, a lot of time to think and analyse, and my therapist encourages me to do both in our sessions, although our encounters are exhausting because I spend them avoiding answering his questions. I know this frustrates him. He senses something I'm not saying, as I suspect the judge did too. But the answer will stay within me. I'm in here, and it's where I should be, where I deserve to be, where I want to be. Restless, I stand, take the few steps towards the other side of my small cell. Through the closed and locked door, I hear the post being delivered to the rooms on my floor. Since being in here, I've received a fair amount of correspondence from various members of the public, keen on an epistolary relationship with a convicted killer. I look up as my door is unlocked. "Letter, Rose," the custody officer says. "Thanks." I nod and take the thick envelope from him. My stomach drops a little, as it always does, when I hear the turn of his key as he locks the door again, despite the fact that a part of me, a big part, is relieved to be in prison. Sitting on the narrow bed, I open the fat letter. I read the first line, thinking I won't go further, but I do. "Dear Miss Marlowe, my name is Theo Hazel. I'm a novelist and non-fiction writer. I followed your case with much interest, and to be honest, intrigue, too. I've written several non-fiction books about women who have been convicted and incarcerated for murder. Your case stood out for me. I'm very keen to meet you, to hear what you have to say. I would, and I'll be blunt, very much like to write your story." At the end of the letter, Theo Hazel lists his 5 published works. 3 are non-fiction. An unaccustomed smile lifts the edges of my mouth at the title of one of them. I'm intrigued, and even though an instinct to like this man nudges at me, there is no way I'll be speaking to him. I cannot. His letter is engaging and he is erudite. He includes lots of detail about his life. I know he's doing this to gain my trust. Tucked away in between the penultimate and last pages is a photo. Maybe he is another mad member of the public. I study the image. Dark hair, quite long, skimming the collar of his cream shirt. A zipped-up black North Face jacket. I'd say around my age, maybe younger. I look again. Yes, a bit younger. I'm good at guessing ages. I think many medics are, from years of looking at birth dates and then at the face accompanying the paperwork. I nail him at 44, maybe 45, 3 or 4 years younger than me. Nut brown skin. I recognize his face from somewhere, and I dig deep into my memory. The man sitting in the public gallery on the day of my sentencing. It is him. I'm sure of it. There is a church in the background, and in the left lower corner, a gravestone. There's a digital number at the bottom of the photo, time and date. It was taken last week. I read through the letter again, happy to be able to put an image to his name. Recently, I've begun teaching basic biology to a few inmates who've decided to broaden their educational CV. I love the teaching, but also the opportunity that being in the prison library gives me. Access to a computer. I will Google Theo Hazel the next time I get a chance. Chapter 3. 22nd of March 2016. Sitting on the edge of my bed, I'm thinking about Theo Hazel's letter. But then my mind flits to the image of Abe's wife in the courtroom. And their baby. I know the child's name and try to unknow it. The inside of my head hammers. I lean forward and stare at the blue of my cell floor. I'll never be able to live with what happened. What is the alternative, though? To not live with it? I'm not brave enough for that, despite what I know is happening inside my body. I've no fear of death, but I can't instigate it. A heavy and solid, terrible guilt drags at me. It's always worse in the late afternoon, and that is when I want to sleep, when I don't want to be alive. Though it's been the same for years, and not only since Abe Duncan's death. Abe died at 9:50 in the evening. The timescale of that day is carved into my soul. I've been working part-time on the unit for 4 years, and my husband, twice as long, as a consultant anaesthetist, when Abe was brought into intensive care. He was admitted on my day off, and when finally I was on the shift coinciding with one of his mother's rare visits to see her son, I don't know who was more taken aback. Her. Or me. I peer at the annoying red horizontal stripe painted midway up the cell's wall, which circumferences the entire room and mirrors the prison's themed decor. Being here is my punishment for everything, and not only Abe. Lying down, I pull a thin duvet over my legs, up to my chin, close my eyes and turn onto my side in the fetal position, Abe inside my mind. My hands are tucked between my thighs, nails digging into the softness. And eventually the sting of ruptured skin hits. And then the bite of salt on my cheeks. The free association bell rings, and I wait for the knock on my cell door, which has been opened in preparation for the part of the day that indicates a type of freedom. I don't particularly like freedom time. Although I do like it when my friend Kathy appears, and thinking of her conjures her up. She loiters outside. What do we have in common, apart from being in here? My therapist thinks it's our lack of remorse. He couldn't be more wrong. As a med student and then a nurse, I was never lured by the alchemy of psychiatry. But since Abe, I've been obsessed with how the mind works, how it shuts off, how it can trick itself, mine and other people's. How it can make a person who has always been one way become another. Hey, you. Kathy takes a step inside my cell. Duvet day? I don't answer, but I know I won't get away with it for long. There is no discernible expression on her features, although I've learned this doesn't mean she isn't feeling something. It's just that her feelings are separate from her, hang outside of her. That small, separate entity understands there is something very wrong with leaving your three kids home alone whilst you go on holiday. But most of her, the other, bigger part, doesn't comprehend this. It's as if there are two Kathys, I've tried to understand why I get to see this separate part of her. At first, I thought it was because she believed I was like her, camaraderie and all that. But I found out that's not the case. I manage a smile. "That's more like it," she says, smiling herself, although Kathy's smiles are always veneer thin. "Don will put you on the happy pills if you stay in bed." I sit up, my head still drumming. I laugh, but it hurts. It would make his life easier. And I think it would. I sense that my therapist doesn't particularly like me. And I can see how perhaps a rose numbed and dumbed with antidepressants might be a good scenario for him. Kathy's smile is now long gone. She pushes me gently and I move over so she can lie next to me. This coziness is alien to her, and I wonder again what it is about me that draws her. Most days I don't like the answer. But despite what Kathy actually is, the bigger part of her, I like the part of her that she shows only to me, or the part only I can see. It's ironic that I'm so discerning in prison. "It's your husband you should be talking to," she says, now under the cover. The bed's much too small for two. The hammering inside my head is now turned into an undulating thrum. My kind and dedicated husband. The man who both saved and condemned me. An hour after Kathy returns to her own cell, the hatch in my door is opened.
"Rose, it's visiting time,"
a custody officer says through the small hole. I look at the calendar. It's not my husband's visit day, but then I remember. I agreed to a visit from my mother. Her request was a surprise. I've not seen her for more than 20 years.
"Did you hear me, Rose?" he's saying. "Your mother, Marion Treherne."
"Okay." I get up as he unlocks the door and follow him through the newly painted corridor, keeping one step behind as he leads me to the visits hall and to my mother. There are around 20 tables in the huge room, and she's managed to sit at exactly the same one as my husband does on his visits. She's peering into a compact mirror and doesn't see me until I'm only a few meters away. When she looks up, I see the ravages of time, undoubtedly mirroring what she identifies in my features. Without wanting to do so, I acknowledge how physically alike we are. Why is she here? Maybe my husband has asked her to come. No, he wouldn't do that. "Hello, Rose," she says. For a moment, I think she's going to shake my hand, and this brings a wry smile. It's been that long. The 5th of July, 1992. The date is hardwired into my memory. I'd gone to visit her, a spontaneous decision, and encouraged to do so because I was planning to get married. Despite everything, I wanted to tell her myself. A stranger answered her front door, and it took a few phone calls to find out she'd moved. When I finally found her and my brother at their new address, I stood outside for at least 10 minutes trying to work out how she could afford a house in a nice part of West Bridgeford. The visit didn't go well. We argued, but about what exactly, I don't know now. I was still raw, and she was still adamant that everything was my fault. My impromptu visit had all the ingredients for the disaster it was. My head thumps. I put out a chair and sit down. This is a surprise. Immediately, I begin to pull at the skin around my thumbnail. She tries not to watch my hands.
"Don't be like that, Rose."
"You look well." She doesn't return the compliment.
"I'm sorry I haven't been before."
"You didn't even come to my hearing." I grip my hands together, attempting to calm myself. She reaches towards me. I don't move or respond.
"You shouldn't be in here," she says.
I'm about to touch her, to try and make peace, because I cannot stand the constant conflict of everything. But then she says,
"You were always a bit unstable, Rose. You should have allowed your barrister to plead insanity."
My hand reverts to its resting place on my knee, my quest for peace obliterated.
"Me? Unstable? That's a bit rich coming from you." Her eyes flick around the room. Always defensive. Always with a temper. Of course I'm defensive. I haven't seen you for over 20 years. And whose fault is that? She says, with her eyes fixed on the visit room's back wall. You carried on working for him. It was a job. I needed the job. You could have found a cleaning job anywhere. I study her coat, which is hung on the side of the chair. Jaeger. When did my mother begin buying coats from there? Probably the same time she moved house. What is this, Rose? I feel as if I'm on trial and I haven't done anything wrong. Haven't you? She moves her chair back. Her coat falls to the floor. She doesn't get up. It was you who cut ties with me and your brother. I haven't heard from him either since this happened. Since before this happened. Since you took the life of an innocent man, you mean? Now she does stand. You were not sane when you did what you did. She puts on her coat. I knew coming here wouldn't work. I'll come another day when you've calmed down. She pauses. I'm sorry, Rose. For what? For not helping me that night. For not being there for me when I needed you the most. You blame everyone but yourself. She takes a breath. You killed a man, and I don't understand why. I don't reply. There is no point. I watch her walk hurriedly towards the exit, then look down. My left thumbnail is streaming with blood. Chapter 4. 24th of March, 2016. I'm sitting at my small desk, pushed up against the side wall of my cell. Bella Bliss's letter laid out in front of me. It's a wonderful name. She's an English literature student at Manchester University, and I find some meaning in this, as her letter came so soon after the writer, Theo Hazel's. You do this in prison. Give connections to things that have absolutely no connection. My yes to Bella Bliss's visit came from a place of loneliness and was perhaps also a reaction to my mother recently dropping by. Bella's currently doing research for her dissertation, which is about works of fiction with a female protagonist who is a murderer. Her letter, like Theo's, didn't read as if it had been written by a mad person. And so in a moment of my own madness, I agreed. The only visitor I get is my husband, and my mother's was the disaster I'd known it would be. My old housemates from university have been to see me once too. I appreciated their effort, but told them not to come again. I can't bear their pity. Or their horror. The custody officer knocks on my cell door, unlocks it and enters.
Change of plan, he says. Bella Bliss is here. But there's also a detective waiting to speak to you.
A detective?
D.I. Alison Greenwood. She'll be seeing you in the room where you meet with Don.
I want to ask if I have any say in who's allowed to interview me, but think better of it and don't even bother asking what this is about. So instead of walking immediately to the visits hall to meet Bella Bliss, we take a detour to Don's therapy room. A woman is standing by the small window. D.I. Alison Greenwood is tall. Her hair is short and straight, strawberry blonde, a perfect bob that oozes efficiency. She gives me a wide smile, and despite the impromptu arrangement, I like her immediately. She has an honest face.
Mrs. Marlowe, thank you for agreeing to see me. It's good to meet you.
I don't mention that I had no choice in coming here. She'll know that anyway. It's nice to meet you too, D.I. Greenwood. She pulls a notebook from her pocket. Takes off her coat, hangs it over a chair and sits down, indicating I should do the same.
This is all pretty informal, Mrs. Marlowe.
Call me Rose. She nods.
I followed your case and hearing with interest.
She pauses.
I'll be direct. It's come to my attention that you were in a relationship with Abe Duncan's father, Daniel Dean, during the early 1990s.
She finds my eyes.
This did not come out at your hearing.
My fingers find the edge of a thumbnail and I start picking and pulling. Alison Greenwood flinches as a bead of blood leaks from my cuticle.
It was irrelevant.
I don't think it was.
Why are you here, D.I. Greenwood?
I'm here to try and understand more about the Mount Clinic, a private establishment in Nottingham that Daniel Dean was heavily involved with during the 1990s, at the same time as he was the manager of Bluefield's private hospital. Any information you might have about the Mount Clinic and Daniel Dean?
She pauses, and an expression of real distress appears on her face.
During the period of your relationship would be very helpful.
She sits back in her chair, more comfortable now she's got all that out. She tugs at her brown fitted skirt. She doesn't look like a woman who would wear a skirt. Perhaps it's her rebellion in the male-dominated world of the police. I've never heard of the Mount Clinic. I study her well-structured features. I don't think there's anything I can tell you. I really don't. Alison Greenwood attempts to muffle an exasperated sigh.
I've tried to locate the records and notes made during your admission to Bluefields Hospital in January 1992. It's something you should have shared with the judge at your hearing, at the very least with your barrister.
She takes a breath.
It would perhaps have had an effect on the severity of your sentence.
I dip my head. My records have gone, I'm guessing.
They have. Though it appears many records have disappeared from that period, not just yours. You were a medical student at the time. Did you ask to see them?
I did.
They were in order.
She clears her throat.
Did you have any reservations about your experience at Bluefields? Before, during, or afterwards?
No. Of course I didn't. This isn't strictly true, because towards the end I did have concerns, although not about the hospital.
There is nothing I can tell you, Detective. I finish.
She closes her notebook and smooths a hand through her tidy hair.
You took the life of a completely innocent man, Rose.
Why? She's looking at me intently now, and I try to erect a mental barrier between us.
I'm glad it wasn't Alison Greenwood who led my case, because the woman sitting in front of me has an intuition the detective who did lead it lacked.
I think of the Deans. And a cold sweat breaks out over my entire body. It's too hot in this room. She carries on.
You'd never seen Abe's mother, Daniel Dean's wife, before you met her at Queen's Hospital, where she was visiting her son. Is that right?
Automatically, my hand moves to my stomach. The hollow pain is still there.
No, I hadn't met her before.
She scrapes back her chair and stands.
In the time you spent with Daniel Dean, did you meet any of his acquaintances? Anyone we might contact in connection with our investigation?
I think of the people I met more than 20 years ago, but I can't give their names to Alison Greenwood. It will open everything up again, within me and around me. I think of my husband. I say nothing.
After a beat of silence, I stand up myself.
No. I don't remember anyone. I watch her. She doesn't believe me. She walks to the door and opens it, but then turns.
Is there something you'd like to tell me? In confidence?
No. But thank you for being kind. She nods and leaves, closing the door behind her. I hear the guard outside locking it, and then the detective's heels click-clacking down the corridor. I slump back into my chair. Listen to the digital clock on the wall and wait for the officer to rescue me and take me to meet Bella Bliss.
Chapter 5. I'm disconcerted after D.I. Alison Greenwood's short interview and the mention of an establishment in Nottingham of which I've never heard. I use the half an hour it takes the officer to return to gather myself. By the time he opens the door to accompany me to the visits hall, I've calmed down. He leads me to the table where Bella is sitting. She has her back to me. She has very sleek dark brown hair and is wearing a sweat top with her university logo on the back. I shouldn't have agreed to this. Kathy said so too. As I approach, she turns. She recognizes me, and a pink tinge appears on her sweetheart-shaped face. She has alabaster skin, and her eyes, a striking violet, sparkle with vivacity.
although she's clearly very nervous. I decide I'm going to make it easy for her, although I don't know what she wants from me. I'll wait to see. She has an A4 notepad in front of her on the table and a neat list of questions. Bella, I say as I sit down. So sorry you've had to wait.
Busy afternoon, I grin, which is a little ironic given my situation.
I want to break the ice. She really does look terrified. Thanks for agreeing to meet me, Mrs. Marlowe. I can almost hear her exhale with relief. I didn't think you would. I give her what I hope is a proper smile. She's about the same age as I was when I met Daniel Dean. So young. I scrutinize her features. It's no problem, but I'm not sure how much help I'm going to be. The pink is now swallowing up her cheeks. It's okay, I carry on. I will try to help. She looks down at her list. Perhaps it would be better if you just ask what comes into your head to start. Make it less formal. She looks at me full on. Mrs. Marlowe. Call me Rose, please. Rose, I'm not here for my dissertation. Oh. And oh, maybe she is a nutcase. I glance upwards and catch a custody officer's eye, but he ignores me. What are you here for, Bella? She shuffles uncomfortably. Something else, but I didn't want to write it in a letter. She appears to be in a horrible torment, and I feel for her, regardless of why she's here. She continues. It's about my brother. He's in a relationship with someone who I think you might have known when you were younger. Whatever I was expecting, it wasn't this. Who is your brother in a relationship with? Ed Madden. My heart drops like a boulder, and I'm sure that if I look down, I'll see it beating on the electric blue tiling of the visits hall's floor. It destabilizes me still. The effect his name has, even this many years later. I don't answer. Can't answer. He told my brother something, and it's killing him keeping it to himself. It's why he told me. She stares at her notebook. I wish he hadn't. Tears mist her honest eyes. But I wanted you to know. What is it you want me to know? A terrible anticipation is rolling through me. Bella fidgets again. She drags her chair backwards. Don't go, please, I plead. Leaning over the table, I touch a notebook. I appreciate that you came. It must be important, what your brother has told you. I shouldn't have come, but I need to know. It will stay between us, I promise. Bella closes her notebook and puts it in her rucksack, but then she pulls her chair closer to the table and lays her arms where the notebook was sitting. Her voice is so low I can barely hear her. Your mum. She stops abruptly and takes a breath. I'm so sorry, but I can't say any more. Please, I say. She gets up, a mixture of resoluteness and anger crossing her features. What you did was terrible. But you should know what was done. She's turning around, leaving. Coming here has cost her dear. I don't want her to get into trouble, and it will not be because of me if she does. She continues. Tell who you want. I don't care anymore. My brother and I will deal with it. I won't say anything to anyone. I pause, find her eyes. She's not going to tell me, but she's told me enough. My mother knows something. She pulls her bag onto her shoulders. I think so. The same feeling I had on the last day of Abe's life returns, and my stomach contracts, as if it's wrapping around itself. I've managed to get out of the meeting with my therapist, saying I have a migraine, which I do. Bella's visit and Alison Greenwood's has unsettled me. Before seeing Bella, I'd replied to Theo Hazel saying I wouldn't be accepting his request to talk with me. But back in my cell, I write to him again. I try to focus on how I will compose this second letter.
Before becoming a writer, he was a journalist, and a good one from what I can glean. His journalistic tenacity evident in the non-fiction books he's written. Brilliantly researched and executed, according to the reviews. He's discovered things about long-ago characters from history, some guilty of their crimes, others who've turned out not to be. I'm worried I might have missed my chance with him, though, and I have to make sure he visits me, because I think he can help me. I stare at the wall, lean back in my chair and touch my right breast. And for the first time in years, a trace of purpose twists through me. It even crosses my mind to make an appointment to see the prison doctor. How can I entice Theo Hazel? He wants a story. He wants to kickstart his career. This is all I know about him, really. I need to dangle my tail in front of him, let him know I'm willing to give him everything, or nearly everything. Eventually, I hope he'll be able to help me discover if what Bella has told me is true. I start to write the beginning of my story for him. My first meeting with Daniel Dean in a restaurant in Nottingham. A day in the spring of 1991. The day I fell desperately in love. Chapter 6. 29th of March, 1991. Leaning against the serving station, I slugged back a double espresso. Christ, I hope Noah can see me. Absolutely nothing should pass my lips whilst on duty. Normally I'd have snuck down to the storeroom to drink it, but I didn't have time. Busy day. My section was packed. Good Friday, and the property tycoons in Nottingham were out in force ordering enchiladas and champagne. What a disgusting mixture. Just like most of the men in there. Some came in with colleagues, some with girlfriends, some with mistresses. None of them ever seemed to bring a wife. As I scanned the tables, my line of vision moved towards the floor-to-ceiling windows that overlooked the parking area, settling on a gleaming white car. Roof down, deep crimson leather seats. 1 monthly payment on that car would equal my yearly medical grant. I sucked in my tummy, preparing to give them what they all wanted. A smile and the promise of a chance. The job was all about the huge tips. Times were good for the diners of muscles, even if they weren't for the rest of the country. Sky-high interest rates had divided the nation into the 0.25% and the rest. The rest didn't come here for the microscopic enchiladas and champagne, and to be honest, they were the sensible ones. I was in a bad mood, which wasn't unusual. The fourth year of med school was killing me, and I was falling behind. Even though I possessed a photographic memory, I was a long way from being a genius. I had to work hard, and to survive, I spent too much time at muscles. But as I sauntered over towards my section, always look as if work isn't a problem, Noah advised on my very first shift, I admitted that that last thought wasn't strictly true. I could survive financially. My mum couldn't. A 30 quid tip saw her through a week's grocery shopping. From the corner of my eye, I saw Miles lifting his arm to get my attention. He wasn't sitting in his normal place by the window at a table for two. Today, he'd taken a table for four. He must be expecting people to join him. I was intrigued as to who they might be. Miles was a quiet and distinguished-looking bloke, a doctor at the local private hospital, and one of the nicer guys who frequented muscles. He always wore a jacket and tie, his hair perfectly cut, short at the back but with length at the fringe, which he swept to the side in a very pleasing way. And he was the epitome of good manners. Sometimes I noticed an oddness about him. Nothing creepy, only that on a couple of occasions he'd seemed a little out of it. His words not quite coordinating with his expression, as if he were drunk or something. But he wasn't a drinker, strictly an orange juice or water customer. I made my way over. Hi, Miles. You expecting people today? He looked up and gave me a massive smile. He really wasn't a bad-looking bloke, just not my type, and too old for me anyway. I am Rose, my boss, actually. You don't mind me taking this table? Course I don't. Want to order a drink while you're waiting? Miles wasn't the most laid-back of men, but today he looked even more uptight than normal. Orange juice would be good, thank you. What's your boss's poison? Daniel will have a tonic water.
I went and placed the drinks order at the bar, served a few more tables, then picked up the juice and tonic water to take to Miles. As I turned away from putting the two glasses on the table, I bumped into a man I assumed was his boss. "I'm so sorry," I said. The man gave a huge, kind smile, and my eyes lingered for a moment on his calm and definitely not unpleasant features. He was a similar height to me, slim, but not skinny, dressed casually, but well thought out. A dark grey fitted shirt, no tie, chocolate-coloured trousers, tan leather shoes. Everything matched in that thrown-together-but-not-really way. Dark eyes, jet-black hair, greying at the right temple only, but no older than 35. Against all my instincts, my stomach pulled. He looked at me, really looked, and my gut inverted. Then he sat down at the table and picked up his drink.
"Thanks, Miles. Cheers, Daniel."
They clinked glasses. "You both ready to order food?" I asked, at the same time clearing away a half-drunk glass of wine from the next table.
"I'm okay," Daniel said. "You?" he asked Miles. "Just a bowl of olives," Miles replied.
"Great, won't be long." I turned quickly, wanting to get away. Miles's boss had unsettled me, although not in a bad way, I had to admit.
"Whoa, slow down."
I'd collided with a customer, and the half glass of wine was now all over his shirt. "I'm so sorry," I said again. I was so bloody clumsy today, and began brushing ineffectually at the spreading stain.
"Hey, I like that."
He grabbed hold of my bum, his fingers startlingly close to where my legs met my groin. I pushed him away. Bloody punters. It was then I noticed the snake tattoos running down each of his fingers. What a creep. His face was a bright and alarming red, and he had "future heart attack" scribbled all over him. Wouldn't last to his late 50s. I really hoped the statistics were right, although I hated myself for even thinking it. It was not the thought of a soon-to-be doctor.
"Keep your hands to yourself," Miles's boss said sharply.
Tattoo man nodded and winked.
"She should watch where she's going," he said, before sauntering off. "You shouldn't have to put up with that crap."
Daniel looked at me, his expression concerned. "Goes with the job. Do you know him?"
"No, I don't, thank God. My apologies for the male species. We're not all like that."
"I know that." I glanced at Miles. He was definitely one of the good ones.
"Maybe we can discuss this sometime,"
Daniel said, his dark eyes shimmering. "I don't go out with punters. I mean, customers."
"My name's Daniel Dean, by the way."
"Rose," I replied. He pushed his chair backwards and sideways a little, away from the table, so he could face me without turning his head.
"When do you finish work, Rose?"
I'd been given that line so many times before, and my stock answer was always, "I'm never sure." It was the answer I'd given to Miles months before.
"6. I'll wait outside in the car park for you."
"Okay." I watched for his surprise at my yes. I was surprised at my yes. But not really. There was something about him. I caught Miles smiling, sort of frigidly, and I felt bad.
"Excellent."
Daniel turned to him.
"Shall we go straight to the hospital? Talk there. Noisy in here today."
Miles nodded.
"Of course."
He was already standing and handed me a £20 note. "But I haven't even brought you the olives, and there's change."
"It's okay, Rose. It's your tip," he said, already walking towards the door.
At the end of my shift, I gave 10% of my day's haul to the kitchen and saw Noah smile at me. The rest would go to Mum. It was exactly 6 p.m. when I left the restaurant. The sun was low and bright, and I squinted as I scanned the forecourt. Daniel Dean was nowhere to be seen. Disappointment flooded through me. I walked round to the back of the building where there was extra parking. And that was where he was waiting. I caught my breath, unsure if it was in delight or anxiety. He was sitting inside a blue Mondeo. Company car, I guessed. He opened the window and grinned at me.
"Glad you came. I didn't think you would."
He wasn't exactly handsome. His nose a little too wide, his chin a little too small. Although I didn't really do handsome. But he was charismatic and different. A strong sexuality flowed from Daniel Dean.
It was unmistakable. He leaned over and opened the passenger door, and I got in. His car smelled of aftershave and leather polish. In the centre compartment, a mobile phone and a brown leather wallet sat in perfect symmetry. A tube of chewing gum lay in exact diagonal alignment across the wallet. A petrol blue jacket hung on a chunky wooden hanger in the back. He watched me take everything in. He missed nothing, and I liked that, because I liked to think that neither did I. Nevertheless, I shuffled sideways, and my hand moved to the door handle, thinking for a moment that somehow he'd lock me in. A mini-movie played inside my head. A long drive to a deserted road, torture, rape, unspeakable things. But the door opened.
You're free to leave whenever you want.
He grinned again. A hint of asymmetry in his features. Maybe the reason he liked everything else uniform. His skin loved the sun, and the colour of his eyes, an intense brown, verified this. I guess a touch of the Middle East in his jeans. Putting the door closed, I said, I don't, as a rule, do this.
Glad to hear that,
he said with an overly serious expression, but amusement in his eyes.
Where do you live, Rose?
I thought twice about telling him, but then loosened up and gave him the address.
I was inside his car, for God's sake.
I haven't seen you in muscles before, I said.
I spotted you weeks ago. It's taken me a while to pluck up the courage to sit in your section.
He'd pulled out of the car park. A motorbike zoomed by, overtaking us. So, Miles works for you?
He's an anaesthetist at the private hospital I manage in the city, but I've known him for years.
Bluefields Hospital?
That's the one.
I wondered if he was a doctor by training, or just an administration guru. I glanced at him. Where are we going?
For dinner. Would you like that?
He took in my waitressing gear, and suddenly I was aware that in the rush to get away from the restaurant, a rush instigated by the thought of Daniel waiting for me, I hadn't used deodorant. Heat rose in my face.
I planned to swing by your house so you could get changed. That's why I wanted your address.
Dinner would be lovely, but will we get a table at such short notice on a bank holiday?
Of course we will. It's not a problem.
He turned his attention back to the road, concentrating on the traffic. The med student in me noted that the joints in his neck were showing a reduced range of movement.
Could be early arthritis, or just tension.
Orthopedics and the mechanics of bones was an area of medicine I had no interest in, but my mum believed there was more money in it than paediatrics. I had no idea how she knew any of this, but she probably had a point. I thought about the year I'd be adding to my training if I messed up my exams. I couldn't afford to fail. I peered through the window at the office blocks lining the road. Working in an office would kill me. But what was the alternative if I failed? Nursing? That would kill me too.
You still here, Rose?
Daniel lanced into my thoughts. Sorry, yes.
I'll sit in the car and wait for you to get ready.
We'd nearly reached my road. Should I make an effort? I asked. I was already thinking about what I'd wear, which was unlike me.
Only if you want to.
He pulled up in front of the dilapidated terrace in the wrong part of Nottingham. Our landlord was useless. Nothing ever got done on the property's upkeep. I was glad Daniel didn't want to come in. It made it easier. That was another thing I liked about him. The way he seemed to know what to do. I suppose that might have been because he was older. He hadn't asked me if I had a boyfriend. And that was another reason I was glad he was staying in the car. My ex was one of my housemates. Tom and I were cool, but our breakup was relatively new and I didn't want to rub anything in his face.
Take your time. No rush.
His expression broke into a smile, the dimple on his left cheek deepening. He really was gorgeous. Give me 10 minutes.
Chapter 7. Theo. 30th of March, 2016. Finding the prison in Peterborough is more difficult than Theo anticipated. He really does need to buy a new sat-nav to replace the one that was nicked a month before, but then he thinks of his bank balance, or lack of balance, as well as the two maxed-out credit cards with a third on its way. His ex-wife's offer of financial help is still stubbornly lurking inside his mind, but there's no way he'll take her up on her proposal, despite being grateful for the thought behind it. Their meeting a week before at the cemetery, when she'd made her offer, was bittersweet, as it always was. Stuck at traffic lights after yet another wrong turn, he takes a gulp of the latte he picked up at the service station and thinks about his son. Tears threaten, and he places the coffee on the passenger seat. He unzips his North Face jacket as heat overwhelms him. He always cries on Elliot's birthday, although as a rule he doesn't allow himself to weep for him at any other time. Sophie and he agreed they couldn't be sad forever. It was one of the things they did agree on, although since their split they've been more united than they ever were during their 15-year marriage. He closes his eyes for a moment and recalibrates his emotions, opens them, and turns his brain away from his son and Sophie, back to his work and the task in hand. He will make this book about Abe and Rose a success. He has to. And he can, because with what Rose Marlowe has already revealed, he has a small piece of dynamite. Throughout Rose's hearing, no one was aware that Abe Duncan's father had been her boyfriend in the early 1990s. Theo spoke with his editor yesterday and heard the enthusiasm in his voice, and he hasn't even mentioned this connection yet. He's keeping it to himself for now. Eventually, he pulls into the only available space in the prison car park, and the decrepit Fiesta shudders to a stop. Unclipping his seatbelt, he grabs Rosie's file from the passenger seat and takes out her letter. It was certainly a turnaround. Her reply to his initial inquiry had been a very polite no, but her second letter arrived within a week of the first and included pages of handwritten text describing her initial meeting with Daniel Dean. Theo could hardly believe his eyes and is still questioning what has changed her mind, because his instinct tells him something has. From the file, he pulls out the notes he made on his meeting with Marion Traherne, Rose's mother. It was Rose who suggested he contact her. "If you're really serious about writing my story," she said, "my mum will be able to give you information about my childhood." Returning everything to the file, he jerks the rear view, checks his reflection, pushes the mirror back, and swings aching legs from the cramped space of the car. He opens the back passenger door and takes out the hold all. Rose asked him to bring her some clothes, specifying Topshop, plain and boring, size 10, 34-inch leg jeans. He suggested it might be better if her mother did the clothes shopping, or Miles. "My mother doesn't visit me, and my husband loathes shopping." He was surprised that prisoners were allowed to wear their own clothes. He can almost smell the conflict and missing information in Rose's story. This really is the most optimistic he's felt about his career for a long time. He's certainly been going through a barren period. Very barren. After 4 okay selling books, he sank into oblivion with the fifth. Several gruesome years followed when nothing he sent to his editor was commercial enough. "Your work's lost its edge," the grey-haired wolf said. An investigative non-fiction book about Rose Marlowe and Abe Duncan is his big chance. It's begun to rain, so he flings a coat over his head and, with the hold-all slung on his shoulder, makes his way to the prison entrance, where he waits with at least 10 other visitors, getting soaked, until the security officer unlocks the door. Theo has never been inside a prison in his life and has no idea about the protocol. He's told to drop his phone, wallet, and the entire contents of his pockets into a box. "Collection on the way out." The hold-all will be searched and taken directly to Rose. Following a grumpy custody officer, he makes his way through newly painted corridors to the visits hall, which features a collection of cheap plastic black tables and even cheaper electric blue chairs placed either side. Two windows sit up near the room's high ceiling, giving the space its only natural light. There are around 20 prisoners dotted around, but Theo recognizes Rose immediately. Dark blonde hair, corkscrew curls, symmetrical features, wide-set eyes, a fine nose, as though it was sculpted from sandstone. Her hair, though, is spritzed with white, more so than when he'd seen her in court, and her skin, normally the color of pale honey, is almost grey, like a sunless English day. Her demeanour is guarded, sunken, but when she raises her head, her caramel eyes catch and hold him. At 48, she remains astonishingly beautiful. She wears a pair of overwashed black jeans and a multicoloured blouse, its crash of shades the colours of an Antipodean coral reef, utterly out of place in this grim location. She moves in her chair, comes to life. "Theo, it's so good to finally meet you," she says, her voice low but distinct. A thread of excitement unrolls through him, and he's unsure if it's because of the story he's already begun to share, or the anticipation of discovering why she's changed her mind about seeing him. She shakes his hand. Hers is warm and soft. "Were you at my hearing?" she asks, "in the public gallery?" "I was," he smiles. "I feel like a stalker or something." He pauses. "How did you know? I didn't mention it in my letter."
"I remember seeing you."
He's not sure if this is a good or a bad thing. She carries on.
"And then the letter you sent me, and the enclosed photo. I remembered your face."
She stares at him.
"It was taken in a cemetery?"
"It was. My ex-wife took it. It was the day he told Sophie about his idea of writing Rose Marlowe and Abe Duncan's real-life story. She was all for it, and this pleased him. Even now, he still needs her approval."
"I see,"
Rose says, interrupting his thoughts, her voice laced with softness and compassion. "I brought you some clothes," he says. "I hope you like them, and they fit."
"Thank you. I shouldn't have asked you. I'm sorry."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.